tried to issue an FPN and the individual refuses to give their name and address. I believe she said something along the lines that that in itself constitutes a call for action. I'm not qualified enough to answer that. I don't know, I just want to make it clear, not to say that that's the case in your case, but if people out there think simply by not giving the name and address, then the issue would go away and be independent. I just wanted to clarify that position, but...
Well, I can clarify as well.
But that is an issue in itself. I'm not saying it wasn't your case. We're saying when you came to a person, you were here, I'm not here, we asked that question, we said, well, I'm simply saying I'm Mickey Mouse or, you know, whatever. That is, in itself constitutes actually an...
She actually said it doesn't matter whether you give me your name and address. And she stood in front of our van and wrote down her registration number. That was her answer to that. So what is, are we allowed to not give our names and addresses?
Again, I would like an officer to answer, but apparently we're not allowed.
When you get an FPN, are you like considered guilty until...
As I understood the evidence, I'm only paraphrasing from the evidence we received a year ago at committee. We asked the question, if someone was, you were challenging for littering, simply said, I'm not going to give you my name and address. In effect, that meant that they would still pursue it, and that became part of the offence rather than of not giving the name and address. Again, I'm looking for officer's license, but apparently not. That's crazy.
I beg your pardon, sorry, Jane.
What's the legal position?
Yes, they must give a name address. I want to make it easier for people to
it. Councillor Sykes.
I think the question, I was only going to back up Steve as a recollection of being in the same meeting as Councillor Fowles that I was.
Okay, can I thank you very much for your evidence? Thank you very much. Sorry, Christina.
Can I speak to generally then?
Yes, of course you can.
If you didn't know that they were Kingham and they came and asked you for your name and address, aren't we getting into slightly dangerous waters, given that quite a lot of dog waters are on their own, and if two people approach you and you don't know, with no way of knowing where they come from, and ask for your name and address?
Yeah.
I'm just slightly worried, because if it was the police, you kind of know it was the police, or assume that they weren't wearing a made-up uniform. But
as soon as she said she hadn't called the police and it was just obvious that she was just bullying and shouting and screaming at us, that's where we went. Because I thought the police were coming out as well.
Yeah.
But,
again, my recollection from the meeting, and we got assurance that we will be reassured again, I'm sure, if anyone replies. These people have to be uniformed and identified as the job they're doing. They can't go around the cities.
But there's nothing. There's nothing could think of it. There's no reproach. The arrogance that they did away with the law.
Listen, I wasn't doubting your behavior against someone else's. I'm simply saying
you don't have to. Okay,
they have to have
evidence.
Uniform. Yeah. I'm just trying to clarify that point. It made it sound as though you didn't recognise them as being doing the job they were doing. They clearly were doing the job. Maybe they were wrong, but clearly you...
They went on the field and taken photographs of each other.
Some of the general questions that the witnesses are making, some of the general questions, not case-specific questions, but some of the general questions can be answered by the officer, and we ask the officer to give his statement.
Thank you.
So
did you get an FPN? You're guilty
until... Not just at the moment, but when the officer gives his statement, we will actually ask some of these questions to the officer, and some of the witnesses can ask the officer of the questions as well. So I personally can't answer them, but we do have a further witness coming on, who's actually an officer who can answer those questions for you.
Can I just ask one question? You know, we've got two arrests or something like that, you've got to remain silent. Have you got that right if they issue an FPN? You haven't given your address.
I personally couldn't answer that, sir. I'm sure the officer could.
As I say, he wasn't even on the field, he was just my driver. But he got issued an FPN just for being there. I mean, it was as well.
Okay, can I thank you for your...
Councillor Patrick, well, you've got Kingdom officers, you know we're going to have to deal with those new FPNs because they'll make sure they're all...
Okay, Councillor Smith.
Just a very quick question.
Yes, sure.
The cabinet member mentioned about an intermediate stage, so when you were then you could actually go to the council to have a look at it. Did that happen with you?
No, I wrote to them, I asked them. They were told in the court that they should show us within 28 days. 28 days came and went, no, nothing, no response.
Yes,
and they wouldn't show us before we went to court either.
Okay, thanks for your time. Can we call our next witness, please? June Ormrod. June, if you're available. Thank you. You've got 5 minutes, June, if you'd like to sit down and use a microphone in front of you. Of course you can. Okay, you have up to 5 minutes. Right, okay, thank you.
June is at Clifford Grange at Supporters Housing. I'm the manager there. So, on the day that this happened to June.
I'd like to turn that microphone around towards you, please.
Yeah, sorry. I work at Clifford Grange. I'm the scheme manager at Supporters Housing. And June's a tenant there. So the day that this happened to her with the Kingdom, she came home and was really distressed. And I gave her support over the thing and tried to help her because I knew it was so unfair and unjust. So I got in touch with councillors and things like that. We took photographs. I don't know if anyone wants to see, but this tiny bit of paper is what this is all about.
On the left-hand side.
It was on the 2nd of March. And June went into town to pound stretchers to buy a portable heater for a friend because it was the day, the feast from the east weather that we had in March. It was really cold. So people on the top floor opposite the river were suffering a bit. And June went to buy her friend a heater. When she came out of the shop, she put it in the boot and leaned into the boot to take the price sticker off because it was a gift. And a little bit of paper stuck to her finger and then blew off in the wind. And then she got into the car. And next thing, a bearded man was knocking on the driver's side window. And it really frightened her. And he said he'd been watching her litter. She committed an offence and she was going to be fined £80. Then she had... I don't know how long you worried about the kitchen. She had all this, she was so anxious, and she's 70, she's never been a litter bug. She's brought up 4 children, 16 grandchildren, nobody litters in her family. She's never committed an offence. So it really shook her, really did. And the fact that she'd been watched as well, because a few years previously she'd been the victim of a mugging. And so she's quite anxious if she's on her own in town, but she's vulnerable, she's disabled. And I thought it was just awful what happened to her. I think the time of it's ludicrous and it's just a money-making scheme. I don't think it's doing anybody on the world any good, this sort of thing, targeting a vulnerable lady like children. In fact, it's doing the opposite. It's making everybody upset and anxious. And hearing the stories today, what it's put people through, it's not anything to be ignored. I think it should be taken seriously. And I feel, because I've got 40 quite vulnerable tenants, and I feel really passionate about it, that they could be taken advantage of like this. And I think the Kingdom need to be spoken to. They need to change their attitudes, really. Sorry, Jim.
Sorry, I'm just upset if I actually read. Sorry. You actually read what I put on my thing. I was 70, I've got 4 children, 16 grandchildren, and I've always shopped in Birkenhead, and now I'm on comfortable going into Birkenhead, was he had his face right up to the driver's side window when he was sat in the driving seat, with his nose pressed to the window, and frightened the living day lights out to me. And all for the, if you want to pass the paper around, it's just for the little slip at the end there. On the left hand side, that's all that took off it, and I gave up then because it wouldn't come off.
Okay, thanks very much. If anyone, any questions for these two ladies, Steve?
I mean, clearly, numbers, certainly not me anyway, this could be any single word you said. I suppose, technically, in the world of Don Litty, that was the case, but surely, common sense would have prevailed in that position.
Yeah.
A lady of your age.
Was actually doing this in the booth before.
Yeah, a lady of your age and previous situation, common sense would have prevailed. In any walk of life, there will be those people who are over exuberant, over enthusiastic to a point of becoming annoying, and that's clearly the case. So, I think what we're hearing is that whatever the outcome of the decision tonight, I think the committee need to get some people in from Kingdom and talk about the procedures and you know, this, the way common sense has got to come into it somewhere, it would get a case like this. I do have to say, though, you know, we have had witnesses, six witnesses who felt really, really hard done by them, except they are hard done by them. There are over 20,000 FPNs have been issued, I believe, is the figures in that region.
Excuse me, can I just say that?
I'm just sort of trying to use the evidence in a positive way for us to do something like that.
The thing is, though, that most of those 20,000 FPNs have been issued, but a lot of people wouldn't have someone supporting them. June had made it to sponsor. If I didn't do anything, she would have just paid that.
Surely, in the criteria of vulnerable people, then, you know, age.
Yeah, but how many people have been fined and paid up?
Well, the only evidence we have is the people who turned up here tonight.
Exactly.
We need obviously to.
It sounds like everything's fine for the other 20,000 people, but I doubt it very much.
Can I just ask if there's penalty, if you both get a penalty fine, is it against your name? Does it come against your name? If it's squashed because of public interest, because the ad hoc councillors are put involved because of
I don't think so. I think it's along the lines of parking fines and parking on private land type fines. I don't think it stays on any sort of thing.
But their
approach is
not
very
good. They're approaching people.
Councillor Brown.
Thank you, Chair. We've heard earlier talk about zero tolerance, and it sounds all very macho, but when we hear the evidence, these two ladies and our earlier witnesses, we do realise that zero tolerance isn't actually always appropriate. As Councillor Flack said, common sense has to come into it at times. And it's really creating unease in me that we have people operating on our behalf within the borough who don't seem to be able to exercise this common sense.
Can I just say thank you very much to the evidence, ladies? Can I also say, councillors, if you are going to ask a question, can you ask a question and not make a statement, please? Thank you very much.
Thank you. I just want to thank the councillors that did help me.
You're very welcome. Thank you. Okay, can I call Andy McPartland, please? Okay, up to 5 minutes, Andy, please. Thank you.
Tom.
Thanks, Chair. Chair, members of the committee, I'm here from the Cabinet Member for Environment. This is the policy background for this recommendation to award a contract for environmental enforcement services to Kingdom Environmental Limited. I shall now seek to address the matters identified in the calling of this decision to provide an operational overview and justifiable reason for that decision. I have broken down elements of the calling and will respond for each. Firstly, however, I will outline the process followed in reaching the decision to award this contract. The contract award recommendation has been arrived at following a robust and transparent commissioning process that commenced in December 2017 to elicit market interest and establish market capacity by a soft market testing exercise, at which three bidders presented outline solutions to the authority. Having been satisfied there was sufficient market interest that would provide solutions enabling the requisite behaviour change and able to contribute to the outcomes and achievement of the environment pledge within the 2020 plan, the Council commenced a formal procurement exercise for environmental enforcement services. The Council received two compliant bids for delivery of these services that were subsequently evaluated by officers within the Commission Services team and the Strategic Hub. The highest scoring bid across both the key price and quality scoring criteria was for Kingdom Environmental Services, which was equally felt to be the strongest of both bids and where the strategic vision is in tune with the Council, and many examples were given that illustrated how partnership working would help to achieve the aims of the contract and the outcomes of the World Plan. The bid scored well in its approach to environmental behaviour change priorities and social values. It was also strong in terms of operational management. The evaluation team is confident this organisation will be able to deliver a flexible and workable solution that meets the needs of the Council. As part of the process, references will also receive from other local authorities who have commissioned the successful provider to undertake similar services. I will now move to address the points raised in the call. Members need to be satisfied there's a proper balance between changing the behaviour of the public and the generation and share of income from fines. In particular, we have concerns about the financial model within the bid being predicated on a per-ticket share of income. The contract model is on a per-ticket basis and is designed to ensure that Wirral's environmental enforcement contract is self-financing and local taxpayers are not made to meet any deficit. This is consistent and in accordance with government guidance on environmental enforcement. The contractor is only paid in cases where a valid ticket is issued. This model has also been adopted by peer authorities. In the event that a ticket is not issued in accordance with the contract, Kingdom will not be paid. Likewise, in the event of an appeal or challenge, and where the Council and or Kingdom review the issuing of the ticket and determine it's not been issued correctly, Kingdom will not be paid. In the event that ticket numbers diminish, for instance, if behaviours were to change, and fewer people were dropping litter, which is where a position we would like to get to, or allowing dogs to foul, then the Council would still be afforded financial protection as the business model is flexible and able to accommodate this. There is therefore no financial risk to the Council, and again, in compliance with government guidance. If an alternative pricing model was used, i.e. on the basis that the Council paid Kingdom officers on an hourly basis, the Council would be afforded no certainty that the cost of providing the service would be commensurate with the income received, i.e. it would cost the Council to undertake the service, meaning any deficit would be undertaken by taxpayers. This is clearly not an acceptable risk in the current financial climate. Point two. The published documentation provides little information on the financial arrangements, costs and income generation in the process of setting targets and spread of activity throughout the world. Members wish to be fully appraised of the way in which priorities are set, resources are targeted and employees are directed and supervised. This is a Council contract and as such, the enforcement priorities by which Kingdom will work will be determined by the Council. This includes for the monitoring and information provision as required as part of the contract, which will be available to members. The Council has full access to Kingdom systems to ensure transparency of real-time employment patterns and schedules, routes worked, known hotspots and areas targeted, and details of performance achieved. The direction and supervision of employees was considered as part of the tender evaluation model, from which Kingdom submitted a thorough and comprehensive training and induction and operating programme as part of this process. This will be available as part of the tender documentation. As has been customary through the previous contract, elected members and other stakeholders are invited and even encouraged to make suggestions and inform the Council's client management team to areas of the borough where they feel there are repeated or significant regular occurrences of environmental crime that can be tackled by Kingdom. Furthermore, and based on stakeholder feedback, the new contract has incorporated improvements that have sought to address the concerns of elected members and residents, in particular the extended operating times of enforcement officers that are now flexible enough to tackle dog fouling offences at their early morning and late evening, which are common times residents walk their dogs. Point 3. Members believe the approach to litter enforcement approved by Council needs to be undertaken in a way that secures public support and understanding. They therefore wish to be satisfied that the aim of reducing litter is not undermined by suspicions of the use generating cash from some crackdowns and fines that lead to the prioritising of some activities rather than others. Area cleanliness is a driver for area local satisfaction. In the most recent Insight survey undertaken by the Council, dog fouling and litter come out to the top local environmental quality issues across the board, with 3 out of 4 constituencies naming them as problems in the local area. It is therefore reasonable to assume that enforcement against such issues will engender public support where the Council can demonstrate it is reasonable, transparent and proportionate. Notwithstanding this, it is still likely to be the case that offences for intentionally discarding cigarette litter are still likely to dominate the FPM figures for 2 principal reasons. Firstly, lots of people smoke on the street, a scenario compounded by the ban on smoking indoors, and as a consequence, cigarette litter still remains by far the most commonly littered item both locally and nationally. It is still nevertheless clarified as litter by the legislation in 2005. Dog fouling will be a priority enforcement activity within the new contract. However, it is notoriously difficult to enforce against, and in addition to directing patrols to hotspot areas, the Council will always look to utilise and act upon information and intelligence provided by stakeholders to direct patrols to ensure improved levels of compliance among dog owners. In summary, there will be no prioritising of activities. Kingdom will enforce in the event that litter drop and were and left or any dog fouls and the owner fail to pick up. The reality is that some offences will be more prevalent and identifiable than others, incorrectly suggesting certain groups are being targeted. However, we will not succumb to differentiating between types of litter for the purposes of what to enforce and not to enforce against. Put simply, litter is litter and intentionally depositing and leaving it is an offence. Item 4. Members seek formal recognition that section 4.21 of the invitation to tender states that the service provider shall deliver the service in accordance with overarching legislation and guidance by the Council. This includes operational statutory guidance. Definite guidance issued on 23rd March 2015 shall be followed. Officers can confirm that by agreeing to the terms and conditions of the contract, Kingdom are obliged and required to deliver the service in accordance with the law, which includes binding guidance. The contract management change control processes allow the Council to introduce revisions or amendments to the contract in the event of any change in law or any change in guidance. Any contractor employed by the Council will need to operate within that revised requirement. Compliance with the law is a standard contract requirement on the part of the Council and its service providers, and assessing ongoing compliance is part of the contract management process that shall be followed properly in all circumstances. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Andy. Committee members. Councillor Cox.
Thank you, Chair. Forgive me, this could go on, but there's quite a few points here I'd like to raise, Andy, because of my first of all. You just mentioned that the priorities under which Kingdom will work will be decided by the Council. Okay, and I think it's pretty clear to see by the discontent with the amount of the public people who've actually turned up to speak today that there has been operational failures currently and in the past. What I would say is, you said it will be decided by the Council. Let's break that down a little bit. What we're actually saying is if they're going to work under the priorities that we're going to set them, and be more specific, it's under Councillor Patrick's, yourselves as officers and the Labour administration need to actually set them service level agreements whereby we are dictating what the direction and the priorities actually are. Litter is litter, dog fouling is dog fouling, but if they're going to work under our guidance, let's tell them what our priorities are rather than leaving them to their own devices, because clearly from the commentary they're not getting it correct. The only other thing I would say as well is that you mentioned DEFRA guidance shall be followed. Now, if I'm not mistaken, DEFRA guidance on litter, so not dog fouling, litter, is that the prosecuting officer or the, whatever you want to call it, attending officer, should actually task the person with picking up the litter first before enforcing, and we're clearly not doing that. That is definitely guidance. They actually say, give them the opportunity to pick it up first, and if not, then prosecute them. We're not waiting to defer guidance at all, so can you tell me what we're going to do on that too, please?
First, priorities are set in accordance with Pledge 20 of the World Plan, which is an attractive local environment, which covers litter, dog fowl and fly poaching. So they're the overarching priorities. If we break the priorities down, we can direct Kingdom to local priorities so they can work with councillors and local constituencies. And I think a couple of members have already said that there have been localised initiatives based on their own priorities. But through the contract management process, through weekly contract meetings with the clients, we can actually say to Kingdom, we want you to deploy in these areas or to tackle these specific priorities. On the second point, Councillor Cox, my understanding is that the DEFRA guidance in relation to picking up applies where litter has been deemed to be dropped accidentally, not where it's been dropped in totality. Otherwise, all litter will be dropped accidentally. So, yes, it is in Kingdom's own training manual where they advise their own staff, if you think that somebody has dropped it accidentally, you should give them the opportunity to.
Okay, thanks very much for that. Can I just, before we carry on, can I just remind councillors that you have an opportunity now to ask questions, not make statements. So can I just remind everyone of that? You can ask a question rather than make statements. But I don't think it's fair that we make statements to the officer, but we can ask questions. Councillor Sykes, you are next.
Thank you, Chair. I just want to ask, given that the council obviously monitor the contract on a going basis, currently in the past and where you're going forward, do you ever sample the cases that come before you to ensure that they're meeting the standards that the council will expect? And also, do you record and discuss with Kingdom the issues where people do challenge them and then they are dropped? I mean, have you got figures on that, and do you monitor those, and do you challenge Kingdom on that?
For you, Chair, we do, Councillor Sykes. Kingdom themselves will do what's called dip sampling, whereby they will look on a daily, weekly basis at various, well, randomly sampled CCTV footage from their offices to make sure that they're sticking to the script. And my contract client team will then do further sampling of Kingdom's activity over any given period, and that is quite, that's been tightened up for the contract going forward, because it's probably fair to say the last 2 years have been we've been learning as we've gone along, and a lot of the things we've learned have been built into the new contract in terms of performance management, because it started off as a trial with for littering and incorporated dog fouling, and the fly tipping came along. So as we've picked up various streams, lessons have been learned, and the new performance management framework will reflect a much greater leaning towards information provision and, you know, tackling some of the learning, yeah, taking some of the learnings we've done in the previous years.
Okay, thanks very much. Councillor Ross, present.
Thanks, Hunting. First of all, slightly following on from what Adam's just said, there seems to be a theme amongst people who've spoken to me and again today about the lack of availability of the CCTV footage, which proves or otherwise, and there was also a question mark over whether that can be in any way doctored. Have you included anything of that in the new contract? Have you spoken to him about that aspect? First question. Second question, if general themes come through from people where they're raising concerns, do you then have meetings with Kingdom about that? And can we see some evidence of that at some point, please? Because I'd like to be assured. Thirdly, you spoke about stakeholders. People have mentioned that they feel as if they've been followed in their vehicles to an area. If somebody reported to you or to Kingdom that they know who the culprit of, say, the dog fouling, would Kingham then be alerted to those people to follow them as some people have felt has happened, because there's a slightly sinister element to that. And the last one, can you assure us that Kingham can identify themselves to people other than by that blue jumper that they wear? Because I know when they came to my own ward, where they were looking at dog fouling at the time, which there wasn't a problem with, they said. They weren't able to. They just had the jumper. They couldn't show me anything else, and I was surprised. But they said they would normally, but they didn't.
Okay. Just a tip to you, Chair. Thanks, Councillor Musgrave. As regards CCTV, it can't be doctored. It's a closed recording that is automatically uploaded to a cloud. So there's no scope for any tampering, I suppose, if that's the word I'm looking for.
So although people have been told to have, you can tamper with it, you're saying you can't?
You can't tamper with CCTV, no. And people have got the, anybody who has been on CCTV for an alleged offence has the right to view that CCTV, and they will be able to confirm whether that's a true representation of what actually took place.
So could you tell me why people are saying that didn't happen?
I can't comment on individual cases, Councillor Musgrave.
But it would go slightly at odds to what you've just said.
It clearly would, but I can tell you that it can't be doctored, and they will know if they're in the CCTV whether what they see is a true representation of what took place.
And do they use their phone cameras?
No, they use body-worn cameras that are encrypted.